Spencer asserts that Islam is not a religion of peace and urges the West to defend its values in his new book, The Politically Incorrect Guide to Islam and the Crusades. He spoke about it at the Young Americas Foundation in Herndon, Virginia for 45 minutes.
We're about ready to get started. My name is Brittany Farrell. I'm an intern with Young Americas Foundation this summer. And we are proud to offer, as part of our National Conservative Student Conference, our next speaker, Mr. Robert Spencer. This is one of the foundation's many conferences. And if you'd like more information about the foundation or our conferences, you can visit our website at www.yaf.org. Mr. Robert Spencer is the director of Jihad Watch, a group dedicated to bringing public attention to the role that jihad theology and ideology plays in the modern world, and to correcting popular misconceptions about the role of jihad and religion in modern-day conflicts. It hopes to alert people of goodwill to the true nature of the present global conflict. Mr. Spencer has studied Islamic theology, law, and history in depth since the 1980s, and has written 5 books. His most recent one is The Politically Incorrect Guide to Islam and the Crusades, which he will be signing after his talk in the hallway. In addition, he has written 7 monographs and hundreds of articles about jihad and Islamic terrorism that have appeared in a number of national and international newspapers and journals, including the New York Post, the Washington Times, Canada's National Post, Human Events, and National Review Online. He has discussed jihad, Islam, and terrorism on a number of television and radio programs, including CNN, Fox News, PBS, The Michael Savage's Savage Nation, The G. Gordon Liddy Show, The Michael Medved Show, and many others. Mr. Spencer has a master's degree in religious studies from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Robert Spencer.
Thank you. I think we all know that even the most glancing look at today's headlines will show that a knowledge of Islam is increasingly necessary to understand today's geopolitical situation. And yet, you all being college students also may know that there are few departments in any university that are more politicized and less intellectually honest in general than Middle East Studies departments. And it is very difficult in those departments to come to any real understanding either of Islamic history or Islamic theology or how Islamic history and theology have anything to do with today's political situation. And that is the reason why, among others, I wrote The Politically Incorrect Guide to Islam and the Crusades, which is the subject at hand today. Of course, the idea of anything that is politically incorrect is to dispel myths and stereotypes, particularly those that are politically motivated, particularly those that are being used to manipulate public opinion and manipulate it in a negative way, and to challenge the straitjacket of political correctness that stifles public discourse with the truth, and to set the record straight about disputed ideas. This has to be done today, particularly about Islam and the Crusades, because increasingly history and increasingly the Crusades are being used to blunt resistance to the global jihad that the United States and the Western world in general face. Both jihad terrorists and leftists today attribute the cause of any conflict between the Islamic world and the West today to the Crusades. Even Bill Clinton a few years ago, right after 9/11. He recounted the story of the first crusaders and how they sacked Jerusalem and pointed out that memories are very long in the Islamic world, which is absolutely true, and that they are still smarting from this and are still reacting to it. It is also true that if you read the communiques of jihad terrorists themselves, which you can do at the Jihad Watch website, jihadwatch.org, you will find that they routinely refer to American forces in Iraq, in Afghanistan, and elsewhere as crusaders. And the, for example, in December 2004, the bombers who bombed the U.S. consulate in Jeddah in Saudi Arabia, they actually referred in their communique to having scored a hit against one of the crusaders' major castles. And this is the terminology in which they routinely frame today's conflict. Now, this is not just rhetorical window dressing. This has everything to do with understanding who they are, what they think they are doing, and most importantly, how we can best respond to it. You cannot defeat an enemy that you will not identify. You cannot possibly prevail against an enemy that you are afraid even to name. And yet, even though, after the London bombings of a few weeks ago, even though every group that claimed credit identified the bombers as mujahideen, as warriors of jihad, and stated that what they were doing was acting in accordance with traditional Islamic principles that were derived from core elements of the religion, even though that is so, Tony Blair and Prince Charles and many commentators in the United Kingdom rushed to say this has nothing to do with Islam and that you cannot speak of Islamic and terrorism in the same sentence, that any connection between Islam and terrorism comes from people who have hijacked the religion and twisted it to serve their own ends. Now, this is all very well, and obviously, there are many people who want to make a case for that. But at the same time, the bombers themselves are not alone, the London bombers are not alone in drawing on traditional Islamic concepts and traditional elements of Islam, including copious quotations from the Quran, the holy book of Islam. They are not alone among terrorists today in identifying their cause so thoroughly with Islam and explaining it in terms of Islamic principles. Now, if they will tell you that what they are doing is acting in the name of Islam and fighting a jihad, that doesn't make every Muslim a terrorist. That doesn't mean that every Muslim in the world wants to kill us. That doesn't mean that this is a good and evil black hat and white hat confrontation between two civilizations. But it does mean that if we are going to understand the enemy in the war on terror and defeat him, then we must know why he is fighting and what he wants. And to this, the enemy himself constantly takes us back to Islamic sources. For example, in the Quran, it says, "Fight against those who believe not in Allah nor in the last day, nor hold forbidden what has been forbidden by Allah and his messenger, Muhammad, even if they are of the people of the book." The people of the book are how the Quran refers to Jews and Christians. So that verse is saying that it is part of the responsibility of the Muslim to wage war against Jews and Christians. And this is what the terrorists are picking up on. Now, you may say, obviously, however, they are cherry-picking verses, and you're taking a verse out of context and using it to establish some point when you can do that out of anything. But the fact is that this is obviously not something I'm doing, but I'm reporting on how the jihad terrorists understand themselves. And this is not, unfortunately, a matter of a few isolated verses that say, to teach something, but it is a much deeper problem. Muhammad, the prophet of Islam, said in a well-attested tradition in Islam in the Hadith, which are the traditions of the prophet Muhammad, which are second only in authority to the Quran in traditional Islam, he said, "Fight in the name of Allah and in the way of Allah. Fight against those who disbelieve in Allah. Make a holy war. When you meet your enemies who are polytheists, invite them to three courses of action. If they respond to any one of these, accept it and withhold yourself from doing them any harm. Invite them," this is the first, "to accept Islam. If they respond to you, stop fighting them. If they refuse to accept Islam, demand from them the jizya." Now, I've quoted to you chapter 9, verse 29 of the Quran a minute ago. I stopped in the middle. It says, "Fight even the people of the book until they pay the jizya with willing submission and feel themselves subdued." The jizya is a tax, a poll tax that was levied in traditional Islamic law on anybody who was not a Muslim. These taxes were so onerous at various times in Islamic history that people had to sell their children to pay them and resort to desperate measures of this kind. As a result, there were huge numbers of converts to Islam because the only way you could live a decent life in these societies was to be a Muslim. And so they would convert. At various points, the conversion rate became so high that the Islamic authorities actually forbade conversion to Islam because it would destroy the tax base. Now, we were at two choices: conversion to Islam or submission as inferiors paying this tax under Islamic rule. The third one that the Prophet Muhammad says is, if they refuse to pay the tax, seek Allah's help and fight them. He also said in another place, I have been commanded to fight against people until they testify to the fact that there is no God but Allah and believe that I am the messenger from the Lord in all that I have brought. Now get this, he follows that up immediately by saying, and when they do it, their blood and riches are guaranteed protection on my behalf. In other words, when they convert, then they're safe. If they do not convert, they will not be safe. Their blood and riches will not be guaranteed protection. Now, this is not the hijacking or the twisted version of Islam that comes from a tiny minority of extremists. This is the word of the Prophet himself and the word of the Holy Book. Now, once again, that doesn't mean that every Muslim takes these things seriously. In any religion, and you, as you no doubt well know, if you yourself are religiously observant, there are people who identify themselves in the religion and take it with varying degrees of seriousness. And there are tremendous differences in the levels of fervor that people have. But that doesn't change the fact that these are elements of Islam, so that when anybody starts to take the religion seriously, then they come back to these things. And these are the elements that end up again and again in the explanations by the terrorists themselves of what they are doing. And that is why they're all the more important. The idea that non-Muslims must be offered by Muslims either conversion or submission or warfare is not only found in the ancient texts. I have in my office a legal manual from the Shafi'i school of Sunni jurisprudence. The Sunni Muslims are 85% of Muslims worldwide, and virtually all Sunni Muslims belong to one of four schools or legal traditions. Islam is a very legal religion, and there are four major schools of law in Sunni Islam: the Shafi'i, Maliki, Hanbali, and Hanafi. The Shafi'i school is centered in Egypt and is headquartered at Al-Azhar University in Cairo, which is one of the oldest institutes of higher learning in the world, and also is probably the most respected authority in Sunni Islam. The New York Times recently called it a beacon of moderation, trying to call Muslims back to the moderate ideals of their religion and to convince them that warfare in the name of Islam was not justified by Islamic texts. That's what the New York Times will tell you about Al-Azhar. But Al-Azhar endorsed as a reliable manual of Sunni orthodoxy this Shafi'i legal manual that was published in 1994. 1994 is not ancient history. 1994 is not really all that long ago. And it says that it is the responsibility of the Islamic community, and I quote, to make war upon Jews, Christians, and Zoroastrians until they become Muslim or pay the non-Muslim poll tax. It adds as a comment by a Jordanian jurist that the invitation to Islam must come first before the fighting. Now, that's very interesting, because if you read Osama bin Laden's communiques to the West, he's written three major ones, one in 1996 and one in 1998, and then one on November 24th, 2002. And in all of them, the first thing he does is call the American people to accept Islam. This is the first thing that he has to do, according to the traditional categories of Islamic theology, before he fights us. And if we don't accept, then he fights. Now, if you go to an Islamic bookstore or go online to islamicbookstore.com or islamicity.com or any of the others, then you will find there, very easy to obtain, prominently displayed, works by two men, one Sayyid Qutb and another Syed Abul Ala Maududi. Now, Qutb was an Egyptian who was a foremost theorist of the Muslim Brotherhood, which is the first modern terrorist group. The Muslim Brotherhood was the forefather of Al-Qaeda and Hamas, the group in Israel that blows up people on buses and in restaurants and then celebrates the victory, so-called. Qutb was a very, very indefatigable scholar of Islam. He wrote a 30-volume commentary on the Quran, which is quite a feat in itself when you consider that the Quran is a very short book, actually. It's shorter than the New Testament. And so to write a 30-volume commentary is going some way. He wrote, extrapolating from the ideas that I have outlined here already, he wrote that it is not the function of Islam to compromise with the concepts of Jahiliyyah. Jahiliyyah is the society of unbelievers. Any state that is ruled by a non-Islamic legal system, Qutb would have considered to be in a state of Jahiliyyah. It's the pre-Islamic period of ignorance. The periods before various Islamic states converted to Islam are also known as Jahiliyyah, the period of ignorance. And he says it is not the function of Islam to compromise with the concepts of Jahiliyyah, which are current in the world, or to coexist in the same land together with a Jahili system. Islam cannot accept any mixing with Jahiliyyah. Either Islam will remain or Jahiliyyah. No half-half solution is possible. The foremost duty of Islam, this is Qutb, is to depose Jahiliyyah from the leadership of man. In other words, any state that is constituted by any system, the U.S. Constitution, the British parliamentarian system, any state that is so constituted that is not obeying Islamic law must be fought. Maududi, the same thing. Non-Muslims, he said, have absolutely no right to seize the reins of power in any part of God's earth, nor to direct the collective affairs of human beings according to their own misconceived doctrines. If they do, the believers would be under an obligation to do their utmost to dislodge them from political power and make them live in subservience to the Islamic way of life. Now, these books are readily available, and they're readily available because they are not tiny minority of extremists who have hijacked the religion. They are mainstream ideas within the Islamic community. They are backed up by 14 centuries of Islamic history that is marked by jihad warfare, and they are backed up by the theology that is elaborated in the Quran, in the Hadith, and in Islamic law. When the terrorists act today, they are acting according to these principles. They are waging war in order to unite the Islamic world under a caliph. The caliph was the successor of Muhammad as the leader of the Islamic community. Because of Muhammad's nature as a warrior prophet, the caliph also was both a religious and a political and military leader. And the caliphate was abolished by the secular Turks in 1924 in an attempt to destroy political Islam and to establish Islam after the fashion of Christianity and Judaism in the West as religions that would be easily compatible with a system that separated religion from the state. It didn't work. As a direct reaction to the abolition of the caliphate, the Muslim Brotherhood, the first modern terrorist organization, was founded in 1928 in Egypt by Hassan al-Banna. And Hamas and al-Qaeda come from that. It was a direct reaction to the abolition of the caliphate was this reassertion of political Islam through these violent terrorist groups. What Osama wants to do, what all the others want to do, all the people who are committing violence in the name of Islam, from Indonesia to the Philippines to Thailand to Kashmir to Nigeria to Chechnya to Bosnia, all over the world, there is in common, they uniformly say, they want to reestablish the caliphate, to restore Islamic law, which is not fully enforced in the Islamic world today, except in Saudi Arabia and Iran, reassert Islamic law, and reestablish Sharia, which is Islamic law, over those states, and then to wage offensive jihad against the West, because it is one of the duties of the caliph to at least every 10 years stage a campaign against the non-Muslim states. they will constantly refer to 1924, the date of the abolition of the caliphate, as the beginning of all their troubles, because it was considered to be the loss of the ability to wage offensive jihad and the loss of the unity of the Islamic world. This is what they say they are fighting for. This is why they took down the towers on 9/11, why there were the London bombings, why there were the bombings in Spain on March 11th, 2004, why there have been 2,647 people killed in the world in the name of Islam since 9/11. Now, if that's what they say, then we have a duty to pay that attention and to take it with the utmost seriousness and not rush to say, no, Islam has nothing to do with this. Because if that's what they say, then the foremost duty of moderate Muslims is not to reassure us, not to reassure non-Muslim Westerners that Islam is a religion of peace, but to convince those guys that they're misusing Islam, if they can do so. But as of yet, there is no American Muslim advocacy group and there is no group of Muslims in the world anywhere that is making any organized effort to convince the jihad terrorists that their version of Islam is wrong. Not anywhere. There are groups in the United States and elsewhere that are taking great pains to convince non-Muslims that Islam is really peaceful and that all this is not really legitimately Islam. But the problem with saying nothing about that and letting it pass by unquestioned is that it leaves us open to being blindsided from attacks from quarters from which we are not willing to admit to ourselves that attacks may come. In other words, we are leaving ourselves open because we are saying that there's this group of people and we're giving them the presumption that every one of them is absolutely loyal to the United States. And there's such a rush to find moderate Muslims that there have been people with terrorist ties who have gone to the White House. There are groups with terrorist ties that are giving sensitivity training on how to deal with Muslims to the Department of Homeland Security and the FBI. And these people have influence at the highest levels of government because there's such an enormous desire on the part of official Washington to say this is not a war with Islam, and of course it isn't, and shouldn't be. But there is such an anxiety to find moderates and to show ourselves to have a face that is positive toward Islam that we are not paying sufficient attention to genuine national security issues that are raised by some of the people that official Washington is dealing with. And this all comes from this political correctness, multiculturalism, and fear to confront the elements of Islam that are giving rise to jihad violence. If the moderates are genuine, then they will be directing their energies to refuting jihadism among their fellow Muslims. If the moderates are really loyal Americans, then they will be opening up the mosques to inspection and to monitoring. And they will be actively cooperating with law enforcement efforts, when most of their energy so far have been directed toward targeting the law enforcement agents for racism or discrimination or various kinds of overreaction or brutality or what have you, because they are going into the Islamic communities. Now look, I'm not saying that law enforcement agents are perfect, far from it, and I'm not saying that they've never made mistakes. But this becomes a question of, well, whose side are you really on? Are you trying to hinder their efforts or help them? Are you going to adopt an adversarial attitude against them, or are you going to cooperate in any way that's necessary? There are a number of things that we must do if we're going to face this threat realistically, and I discuss them in more detail in the Politically Incorrect Guide, but there's a little bit that we can discuss here. For example, the president said, right after 9/11, he said, you're either with the terrorists or you're with us. And yet, one of the states, actually the state that is the leading state sponsor of terrorism, a state that up until about a year ago, long after 9/11, had on its website, out of its embassy in Washington, the idea that it was the responsibility of Muslims to establish Islamic states and to hate Jews and Christians and to work against their holding any political power. A state that gave us 15 of the 19 hijackers who crashed the planes into the World Trade Center and the Pentagon, a state that has demonstrably supported other terrorist organizations and has given billions of dollars to jihad terrorists in Israel and elsewhere, that state is still counted as an ally of the United States. And of course, I'm talking about Saudi Arabia. The fact is that if we are going to seriously call the terrorists to account, then it has to be done on the basis of a redefinition. Terrorism is a tactic. It's not an enemy. Terrorism has been used by many groups throughout history, defined as attacking civilians in order to demoralize and confuse the enemy. Terrorism is a tool. To have a war on terror is like having a war on bombs. It's targeting the tool instead of the user. Now, I know the war on terror is over. You may or may not have heard that it's now a war against violent extremism. But even that is not defined sufficiently. Until we are willing to say, these men identify themselves as Islamic mujahideen, as Islamic jihadists, and therefore we will identify them as such also. And we are in a defensive action against a global jihad, and therefore any state that teaches this jihad in its schools, in the mosques, any state that exports jihad literature, any state that persecutes non-Muslims, will be no friend to the United States. That would seem to be a common sense first start. Another one would be immigration policy. Sanity and immigration is something, well, sanity and immigration just don't go together right now. Sanity in immigration would involve at least having some serious background checks when up until far too late, people from Saudi Arabia itself were actually on a fast track for U.S. visas because Saudi Arabia was such a close ally of the United States that they were given preferential treatment and helped to get into the U.S. more easily than people coming from other places. Now this is beyond absurd. And there has to be a restoration of some kind of serious checking, especially from states where there is demonstrable jihadist activity, which is a growing number of states at this point. At least have some sanity in requiring some proof that the people who are coming in have no connection to these groups. You'd think this is being done. It's not being done. Monitoring the mosques. People have objected to this and say this interferes with freedom of religion. It doesn't interfere with freedom of religion. It's perfectly within anyone's right to go into a mosque, to read the Quran, to pray to Allah in the prescribed Islamic fashion. The line can and should be drawn as to when in those mosques sedition is being plotted against the United States, then that is not acceptable and does not fall within the protections given to religion by the Constitution. And it is being done. We know that the Lackawanna Six, a group of young men in New York, Yemeni Muslims, were recruited in their mosque by an Al-Qaeda recruiter to go to Afghanistan to try to join up with Al-Qaeda not long after 9/11. That is unfortunately not the only example of jihadist activity going on right in the United States in American mosques. Why can't we go in there and simply pay attention to what's going on? We ought to. Above all, and this is a key point in the Politically Incorrect Guide to Islam and the Crusades, we need to recover pride in our own cultural heritage. If you are in college now, you probably have encountered people who think that there is nothing good about the West, that there's nothing good about Western civilization, that all that Westerners have been are rapacious imperialists and colonialists who have subjugated and oppressed the rest of the world. Have you ever heard that? Yes, I expect you have. And in the 1970s, there was a scholar, so-called, named Edward Said, who wrote a book called Orientalism, which destroyed Middle East studies in the United States. And he posited in his book that any criticism of the Islamic world from the West was ipso facto racist and imperialist and could not be countenanced. And of course, given the zeitgeist at the time and since then, that has been a hugely popular idea on college campuses, making critical study of the elements of Islam that give rise to violence absolutely impossible on campus, and also vilifying the West, and particularly the Crusades, as being the cause of all the troubles. Well, I'll tell you, the Crusades were a much delayed defensive reaction to Islamic Jihad. Islamic Jihad warriors came out of the Middle East, came out of Arabia in the 7th century, and they conquered very swiftly the Middle East and North Africa. The Middle East and North Africa were Christian lands and had been for hundreds of years at that time. They had not attacked Arabia. They had not threatened the Muslims. There was no provocation for the attack. It was mandated by the jihad imperative. 450 years after these unprovoked attacks had led to the Islamization of all of North Africa, all of the Middle East, and significant portions of Eastern Europe and Spain, only then was there any reaction in a military form from Europe, and that was the Crusades. And they were only trying not to roll back the whole of these conquests, but simply to gain control of the Holy Land so that Christian pilgrims there would be safe. Now, I am not interested, and I'm not going to defend every aspect of the Crusades. There were many things about them that went wrong. But nonetheless, the effort itself was nothing that any Westerner who is a son or daughter of the Crusaders needs to be ashamed of. This was a response to aggression, not an aggression. There was nothing colonialist or oppressive or imperialist about it. And that is just one aspect of the cultural counterattack that we need to mount at this point, because if we are going to be ashamed of ourselves, of our history and of our heritage, then we will not be interested in defending what our history and heritage have brought us. And we will not have the spiritual energy to resist the jihad that is advancing not only militarily, but in many, many ways, in more subversive ways, in Western Europe and the United States today. And so it is not cultural cheerleading or Western apologetics to stand up, or religious Christian apologetics to stand up and say that Western civilization has been a great civilization and has built a great thing that is unrivaled in the world. We are defending notions of the universal dignity of all people and of the human rights of all people that are actually expressly denied within Islam, which institutionalizes the discrimination against women and non-Muslims. And we should make no apologies for that. That is, as a matter of fact, all the more essential given the headlines every day. So thank you very much. At this point, I'll take a few questions if you have any.
From California, and a lot of times that's the hottest topic actually in every university. And many professors mentioned that, well, Christians came to Americas and destroyed all the natives and killed, and there was a genocide, and also they often mention Catholic Inquisition. And they say that, well, Christians were terrorists too, so in history, some or other religion has that problem, and it doesn't mean we have to go after Muslims this time. So what would you say to that?
Many things. One of the things is no culture is perfect, and no history is spotless. And don't get maneuvered into the position of having to defend everything that's ever happened in the Western world. That's just a red herring. Because as we all know, two wrongs don't make a right. And the fact that one person has done something wrong doesn't mean it's okay for somebody else to do something wrong. The fact is that there is no global organization, and never has been for that matter, of Christian or Jewish terrorists who are pressing forward with explicit reference to Christian or Jewish scriptures to establish a Christian or Jewish state with the hegemony of religious law. There is not now or ever has been, but there is a global movement of Muslims who are acting in the name of Islam with copious references to Islamic scriptures to establish Islamic states and to subjugate the world under that rule. Now, the fact that Christians may have done something wrong 500 years ago doesn't make it any less true that it is Islamic terrorists who are menacing the world. And so the question is not who is sinless in this. Nobody is. But the question is, what is the obstacle that the world is facing? What is the challenge that the world is facing today? And what the challenge that the world faces today is from Islamic Jihad. It doesn't mean at the same time that we must go to war against Islam or declare all Muslims the enemy. As I said before, there's a great spectrum within Islam itself. But we have to challenge Muslims of goodwill to face up, to admit to these elements of their religion, and to admit that the terrorists are working from a broad mainstream tradition within Islam, and challenge them to stand up to that and work to reform it, if they can. And to stop this denial and obfuscation that is almost universal in the American media and among from Muslim spokesmen today, where they say, no, 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 this is not in Islam at all. We have to challenge them, and at the same time say that we need to maintain a strong defensive posture against this, and that the fact that there was an Inquisition or something doesn't mean that we shouldn't defend ourselves against this at all. When Jerry Falwell starts beheading people, then I'll worry about him. Until then, to make some kind of equivalence argument is ridiculous.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Christina Blair. I'm a student at American University. I think it's important as a society we stress that not all Muslims are terrorists, but so far, have you know, as we've seen, all the terrorists have been Muslim. What is your view on racial profiling, and do you think we should use that as a tactic to better protect our nation's transportation systems?
Yeah, a couple things. In the first place, I'd like to say, well, certainly you're right in a certain sense that since 9/11 all the terrorists have been Muslim, but as I pointed out before, that's not even altogether true, because there have been terrorists of all kinds all over the place. I'm not going to name any names because that will divert the whole discussion, but you look back in history, terror was not invented in Islam. But the fact is that what we are facing is Islamic jihad, and we have to acknowledge it as such and face it as such. In terms of racial profiling, that's only of limited value. I have no objection to it being used, but we should keep a steady and sober regard for a couple of facts. One is Arabs. People use Muslim and Arabs as synonyms, and they're not. 77% of Arabs in the United States today are Christians, not Muslims. And they're here because life became so difficult in the Muslim states where they came from. Most Muslims in the world today are not Arabs. The largest Islamic state today is Indonesia, which is not Arab. The second largest Muslim population in the world today is India, which is not Arab. Pakistan, Iran, Afghanistan, not Arabs. So racial profiling has only a very limited value. What we're dealing with is an ideology. An ideology is very hard to defend against. You can't look at someone and say that this guy is going to be an Islamic terrorist. Ibrahim Hooper, the spokesman for the Council on American Islamic Relations, is an American convert. He's blonde and blue-eyed. So, you know, how are you going to know to stop him in the transportation system? It's impossible. Not to say that Ibrahim would have a bomb, of course he wouldn't. But the fact is that we need to confront the ideology, and that's what we're not doing. And that's why we are increasingly vulnerable to the activities of Islamic jihadists. Now, in terms of law enforcement, in terms of protecting the transportation systems and so on, I do think that profiling is of some value, limited value, but it certainly should be employed. And I don't have any objection to being inconvenienced in that way, whether I'm the one who searched or whether I'm held up because some other people are being searched. If I'm not doing anything wrong, I don't have anything to worry about. And if I'm really concerned about the safety of the United States, then I shouldn't mind a few inconveniences. I mean, airport security is a farce, but at the same time, I don't really mind their checking grandmothers and such, because ultimately, one would hope they might catch a few jihadists in the net at the same time. Maybe not. But obviously we need to have a little more sanity about that. But we need, above all, to confront the ideology.
Hi, Amanda Berry, MIT. And my question was, after 9/11, there's been a huge outpouring of Christian missionaries going to, you know, other Arab countries or Muslim nations. How do you feel about that, being, you know, part of that religion and whatnot?
Well, I'm not a Muslim myself, actually.
Oh, sorry.
But, as a matter of fact, I do believe in the freedom of conscience, and I alluded in my talk to how Islam denies various aspects of the rights of human beings that we take for granted in the West, and one of them is freedom of conscience. All right, Islam. The Prophet Muhammad said, "Whoever changes his religion, kill him." And Islam has traditionally taught that anybody who leaves Islam should be killed. And I have a very good friend that I co-wrote a book with a few years ago who is a Kurd who was a Muslim who became a Christian. And he changed his name. And he changed his name not only for his own protection, but to protect his family, which is still back in Iraq. He said, if they know who I am, they will go and kill my family. And this is no joke. This is a very serious thing. And this is a serious human rights issue that the human rights organizations and the human rights establishment and the United Nations are completely ignoring. As a matter of fact, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights of the United Nations guarantees freedom of conscience, and it was put in there by Charles Malik, a Lebanese Christian, who knew that this was something that had to be confronted about Islam. And the Islamic States, the Organization of the Islamic Conference, 56 states, went to Cairo in 1990 to frame an Islamic statement of human rights that absolutely rejected any element of the Universal Declaration that contravened Islamic law, which means no freedom of conscience. Now, as far as I'm concerned, freedom of conscience is a human right that ought to be protected and defended, and so I have no problem with missionaries of any kind going anywhere. This should be something for the individual conscience to accept or reject, and not any matter of coercion of any kind.
My name is Darren Schirmer, and I'm a student at the University of California, Riverside. How would you respond to British politicians, including Tony Blair and the mayor of London, after these attacks? They were saying statements like, these attacks will still come, and we'll still have this problem unless we solve the Israel-Palestine conflict.
Yeah.
Do you think they're misdiagnosing the problem?
Oh, yeah. One of the things, if you'll pardon me for mentioning the politically incorrect guide again, is one of the things in it that I discuss is the phenomenon of pretexts. All through Islamic history, you will find calls to jihad, and this was true at the time of the Crusades as it is true now, calls to jihad framed in terms of contemporary geopolitical events that are presented as making it necessary for the Islamic world to defend itself from unprovoked attacks. So I told you, and it's abundantly historically demonstrable, that the Crusades were a defensive reaction, a delayed defensive reaction, to 450 years of Islamic aggression. But when the Crusaders actually arrived in the area, Islamic preachers went around acting as if this was a bolt from the blue, that the Franks, as they called them, had no reason to be there, and they had done nothing to bring it on, and now they must defend themselves. And it's the same throughout history. No matter what the Muslims do, it never counts for the Muslims. You will always find the preachers of jihad saying, we have to defend ourselves against the retaliation. We see it again today with Iraq. Iraq and Afghanistan followed 9/11. But if you read the jihadist communiques today, they will say, we are fighting because of Iraq and Afghanistan. We are fighting because of Abu Ghraib. We're fighting because of whatever else. But never will they confront that they are fighting because they brought this on themselves with 9/11. It's the same thing with Israel. There were jihad warfare, there were jihad wars and jihad conquests for centuries upon centuries before Israel was ever even contemplated, much less did it exist. The Muslim Brotherhood, the first modern terrorist group, was founded in 1928, 20 years before the State of Israel was founded. What grievance did they have in 1928, if this is all about Israel? What grievance, what do the jihadists who are fighting today in Indonesia care about Israel? What will their fight in Indonesia do to hurt Israel? What do the Filipino jihadists have to do with Israel? What about Kashmir or Chechnya, the Beslan massacre? What do those jihad terrorists have to do with Israel? This is a completely ridiculous thing when you look at in the first place, at history, and second, at the totality of the global situation and the fact that there are jihad wars all over the planet today, and not just in Israel.
Thank you for your insights.
Thank you. One more question. I'm sorry for the line there.
Hello, Anna Lytle from University of Baltimore. Many of the great world religions have gone through schisms and have evolved over time, such as the Roman Catholic Church. At a time, they were having people pay to get their relatives who've been dead forever out of purgatory. Do you see Islam going through any change, a schism to maybe get these radicals or the people taking it this way out of their religion?
Well, there's a problem. There was already an Islamic reform. If you take the Christian model as a loose analogy, and I mean very loose, the reformers, Martin Luther and Calvin and all the rest of them, were attempting, whether or not they succeeded, I suppose, is a matter for the individual to decide, and I don't want to get into it, but they were attempting to restore the original purity of Christianity and to remove things that they thought were corruptions of the original message that had crept in over the ages. That already happened in Islam. The reformer was named Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Have you ever heard of Wahhabism? Wahhabism is a reform movement within Islam that attempts to do just what Luther attempted to do in Christianity. Go back to the basics, go back to the original thing, peel away later additions. And the Wahhabi form of Islam that resulted is more virulent, more intransigent, and more violent than the others. That's one thing. Another thing is that there are reformers today within Islam, and for that we can all be grateful. And I wish them all success. Nonetheless, let me tell you a story about what they're up against. Sulaiman Bashir was a professor in the West Bank, and he taught his class that the Quran was the product of historical development. In traditional Islamic theology, the Quran was delivered in pristine form, through the angel Gabriel to the Prophet Muhammad, and that it's a copy of the Umm al-Kitab, the mother of the book, which existed forever in heaven with God. Now, the idea that the Quran is the product of historical development directly contradicts all that, but it does allow for reform, because then you can look at various elements of the Quran and say, no, we're not going to go with that anymore. This is historically outmoded. His students threw him out the window of the classroom. This is the kind of violence that all reformers face, because in Islam, a hypocrite or an apostate is to be punished with death. And the jihadists consider anyone who attempts to reform the religion as a hypocrite or an apostate. So I don't have high hopes for Islamic reform, but I certainly wish them well and would like to do all possible to support them. But they face a very difficult and uphill battle. Once again, thank you very much.
Robert Spencer is director of Jihad Watch and an adjunct fellow with the Free Congress Foundation. He's author of Islam Unveiled and Onward Muslim Soldiers. His latest, The Politically Incorrect Guide to Islam and the Crusades, is published by Regnery.